Studenti und Kollegi, welcome to my inaugural lecture. The title of this lecture, Brexit, A Million Mad Questions. And we're very privileged to have here His Excellency the Chargé d'Affaires, Tim Coley, to perhaps comment on some of these aspects. And then, of course, we'll have a broader discussion, perhaps with your questions, observations. So I'm going to cover a million mad questions in about 30 minutes. So that's perhaps a little too ambitious. It's inspired by a headline in the Financial Times on the weekend after the referendum that now the UK was confronted with these million mad questions. And what I want to do is to perhaps look at some of the antecedents to the referendum, to put the referendum in context, to look briefly at the result, to look at the Brexit debate very quickly, to look at the ambition of the Intergovernmental Conference 2016, which had aimed at enhancing the UK's special status within the EU. I'll be making a few comments on the nature of the EU legal order, this perception in the UK of EU law as a straitjacket, something that you can't escape from, that doesn't give you any room for manoeuvre. And of course, Section 5 inside the straitjacket, so what it's like to be inside the straitjacket, what a terrible place that is. Article 50, we'll be looking at the withdrawal procedure under Article 50, and hopefully we can cover about 800 years of constitutional history very, very briefly, because this all goes back to these wonderful prerogative powers, the prerogativa canalistica. And so we'll be doing a little bit of work on that. Perhaps looking briefly at the potential status of the UK outside the EU, and then perhaps to look at some wider conclusions, including conclusions relating to Latvia. Could Brexit happen in Latvia? Could there be a Lexit, for example? So antecedents. First of all, very briefly, perhaps we should put this vote in a wider context of perhaps concessions to or expressions of Euroscepticism. Not necessarily originally intended as expressions of Euroscepticism. Perhaps the referendum lock that the government put in place in 2011 was perhaps to guarantee certain aspects of EU membership, or that if there was a deepening of integration, that would be subject to a further referendum in the UK. Opposition to the Juncker presidency, I think that was quite deep in the UK. The 2011 competence review. This was a review of the balance of competences between the EU and the UK. And this was very important. The results of that competence review, it wasn't a foregone conclusion. I think it was a very robust procedure. And the results of the competence review were that there were no issues with competences. And so it seems a little bit odd after the competence review to have had the referendum. If there was nothing wrong in the balance of competence between Brussels and London. And of course, we've got an ongoing debate on immigration. And perhaps in this context, the pledge to hold a referendum must be seen as a tactical pledge. It was a tactical pledge to hold the referendum. And I suppose perhaps the the Conservative Party anticipated not having to hold the referendum. So it's one of those occasions where politicians are faced through their own success with a pledge that perhaps they had entered into for political considerations. And I think this is where the whole process becomes so difficult, because we're entering into this world that is led by politicians. So it is perhaps not the, perhaps not so transparent to us. The referendum result, I think you can see here the majority in favour of leaving the EU, 51.9%. And you can see that there was a majority in England and Wales for leaving the EU. There was a majority for remaining within Scotland and Northern Ireland. And I think you can see immediately that this leads to problems within the UK. I put a further breakdown of some of the percentages. Perhaps what I might do is perhaps I'll put a shortened version of this PowerPoint presentation on the web, and then you can perhaps look at these statistics, perhaps on a snowy evening in Riga. To say that the EU has had a bad press in the UK is an understatement. Virtually every legislative initiative that comes from the EU has been the subject of press outrage. The efficiency directive, for example, was seen as a threat to the English Sunday roast, that your cooker would no longer have the power to cook food properly. The credit card perks, a measure of consumer protection designed to save consumers over 4 billion euro in hidden credit card charges, was covered as an end to credit card perks. So a very hostile press atmosphere. Measures to combat sexual harassment at the workplace were portrayed as meddlers wanting to ban drinkers from calling barmaids love in the pub. There are many more of these stories, but I think that's a significant story in the process, that there was a media hostility to the EU. Perhaps more seriously was Lord Neuberger's Freshfields lecture. I can put a link to this lecture on the website as well, so we can listen to Lord Neuberger. He identifies a number of characteristics which explain this Euroscepticism, this particular Euroscepticism in the UK. Perhaps the status as a premier top nation, and this issue of parliamentary sovereignty, and that Brussels is seen as invading this space of sovereign power. And of course, this comes up again in the context of the royal prerogative, because of course it's the crown in parliament which has the power. So I suppose if we were to put this in perhaps more artistic terms, we have this idyllic state of the UK, which is threatened by this terrible bureaucracy. And perhaps it should be taken seriously, this alienation that perhaps ordinary people feel about this kind of architecture. And the worst thing is being placed in this straitjacket. Never do an internet search for a straitjacket. And of course, when you're in the straitjacket, you are governed, and this is very appropriate for Brussels, by the faceless bureaucrats. So it's straight out of René Magritte's works on the bureaucracy. And of course, no speech about the EU and the UK is complete without mentioning Shakespeare. Paul Craig has written a fantastic article on the whole Brexit process in the European Law Review. He refers to virtually every single Shakespeare play, Timon of Athens, King John, Troilus and Cressida. You get full value for Shakespeare. I've decided to go with Henry IV. And of course, here we have Anthony Scher, one of the finest Shakespearean actors, in his role as Jack Falstaff in Henry IV. And Jack Falstaff is the lovable rogue. Perhaps he's not a very sympathetic person, but banish Jack, and you banish the world. Don't we lose something for not having Sir Jack Falstaff as an MEP in the Brussels Parliament? The Brexit debate, I want to really look at this very briefly. I think there were certain presumptions about the debate. That Remain was the obvious proposition, that the government didn't have a contingency plan for the rejection of this proposition. There was a presumption that there was a legitimacy crisis in the EU. I think both sides came across as Eurosceptic, but in different ways. There were the advocates of Remain, who were Eurosceptic, who thought that the EU required fundamental reform, and I suppose the Eurosceptics on the Leave side, who thought that the institution could not be saved. One of the complicating factors, there was no referral to the 2012 review of competences, and I think this was tragic. Why didn't Remain refer to the review of competences? Well, perhaps because it would have questioned why a referendum was being held. Now, you couldn't refer to a review of competences which said that there was nothing wrong between the balance of competences between Brussels and London. And of course, this meant that there was very little substantive debate. Brexit, their campaign, could oscillate freely between xenophobia and those claims of the costs of the EU. And of course, if you're unrestrained by substance, you can make promises to the electorate and you can inflate the costs of EU membership. And so I think the EU membership was seen as costing £350 million a week. And with this money, you could make spending commitments to the population. I think it was £111 billion worth of spending commitments and tax breaks that the Brexit side made. So I think those are a few of the central presumptions. The case for Brexit, the case for Remain. Perhaps I'll leave these for you to look at in the presentation. And I suppose what we have is we have this attempt in the 2016 intergovernmental conference to enhance the status of the UK. So before the vote, there was an attempt in this intergovernmental conference to reach some sort of enhancement of the UK's status in the EU. But of course you could say that the UK already had a very special status in the EU. It was outside the Schengen area, outside the Euro. There was a special status on the application of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. Important opt-outs on the Working Time Directive, for example. There was the budget abatement. So you might say that the UK already had significant special status within the EU. And we can see the government's objectives in the intergovernmental conference, partly reflected in the then Prime Minister David Cameron's Bloomberg speech in 2013, a few areas where the UK wanted an enhancement of its status, especially guarantees on the Eurozone, excusing the UK from this idea of an ever closer union. Now, to some, this is seen as simply cosmetic, no longer being committed to ever closer union. To others, it is a fundamental reversal of the integration dynamic. So some people see this as trivial, some people see this as much more fundamental. So a number of targets, denying EU migrants benefits, in-work benefits for 4 years, ending the export of child benefit payments, no free movement for new EU states, and of course competitiveness were other objectives of the UK government in the run-up to the Intergovernmental Conference. These are the results of the Intergovernmental Conference. No budgetary responsibility flowing from the Eurozone commitments. An undertaking on competitiveness. A confirmation that the UK is no longer subject to this ever closer union, and that there will be treaty revision on this question. And perhaps the two most important concessions, the indexation of child benefit, of exported child benefit, and an emergency brake on in-work benefits, or the potential to apply to Brussels for a brake on in-work benefits. And I think that both of these fall short of the original objectives. Remember, the original objective was to end in-work benefits, and it was to end the payment of exported child benefit. So you can see this is the result of a compromise, but it fell short of what the Prime Minister had set as a target. So what was a tremendous compromise by the EU member states and by the Latvian government was seen domestically in the UK as falling short of the objective that had been set. And the Prime Minister supported the compromise that was made, that this would give the UK the best of both worlds. So out of the single currency, the no borders agreement, of the ever closer union, but into the things that work for Britain. I suppose the next part of my presentation, I want to just look at the nature of this straitjacket very quickly. And this is the perception in the UK of EU law as being a straitjacket, that the legal order doesn't give the UK any options. I'm sure that most of you in this room are tired of hearing about Van Gendenloos. And so I just remind you that the community constitutes a new legal order. Equally, I'm sure that most of you are familiar with the principle of conferral of powers, with the caveats of subsidiarity and proportionality on the acts of the EU, the fundamental values contained in the Lisbon Treaty, and I'm sure you're all familiar with the ordinary legislative process, the requirements on voting in council, I'm sure you're all familiar with the role of the national parliaments. The idea that the EU is governed overwhelmingly by indirect administration, in other words, the member states execute EU policy, and those operational doctrines. And of course, if you've studied EU law long enough, you know how we can use those operational doctrines to torture first year EU students. These doctrines of direct effect, supremacy. You don't get any special prizes at the end of the academic year if you've taught EU law to first years, because they don't appreciate these kind of ideas. Perhaps also on the enforcement, and crucially the idea of that preliminary reference, that idea of the preliminary reference. Now, if this is going too fast for you, I will be putting this PowerPoint presentation up on the web so that you can go through these points again. I think we all think of the preliminary reference as being perhaps the most important instrument for enforcement, but of course it's ad hoc, it's subject to the national court's determination of whether or not to refer a question to the Court of Justice in Luxembourg. And of course that is subject to the famous Silfitor Act Clear doctrine. And I think what you might see in all of this is that the EU legal order is not necessarily so much of a straitjacket, that the member states, the administrations, the judges in the national courts, they have significant leeway. And so this is why I'm looking at inside the straitjacket, and perhaps we can contrast different approaches towards referrals to the Court of Justice. And I've just put down slides here for two cases, for Mangold, which was a German reference, on measures, well, I'm sure you've heard of Mangold. These were German measures to make the employment of older citizens easier. And there was also another case, Kuckuck de Vinci, which was also on measures to, they were measures that were targeted at younger people and how they could get onto the into employment. But both these cases were referred to the court, and this is what the German Constitutional Court said about this relationship between national and EU law. And I think one of the surprising things that the court said, and this is the German Constitutional Court saying that the Court of Justice of the European Union has a right to tolerance of error. Has a right to tolerance of error. So this followed a reference from the German court to the Court of Justice, and it was referred back, and this was the judgment of the German the Federal Constitutional Court. I think we can compare that with the Abbey National case, which concerned the Unfair Terms Directive, and the precise interpretation of Section 6.2 of the Unfair Terms in Consumer Contract Regulations, which was the UK transposition of the directive, of the Unfair Terms Directive. And essentially, it was about the balance to be struck between freedom of contract and consumer protection. So how do we balance consumer protection and free movement of contract? How broadly do we exclude the core of the bargain from the fairness assessment? And this is a reading in the Supreme Court. So the highest court in the country. Lord Walker, if, as I understand to be the case, the court is unanimous that the appeal should be allowed, then in my opinion, we should treat the point as Act Clear. Now, of course, we remember Act Clear as the Silfit Doctrine. it doesn't really mean that if the court is unanimous, it can choose not to refer. If there is a question of interpretation, it must refer. But was there any unanimity? Lord Walker says the reason for not referring is the delay that referral would cause. Lord Phillips disagreed that it was act clair. So it doesn't seem to be so much unanimity. Lord Mance, the likelihood of the Court of Justice accepting the Court of Appeal's approach to the interpretation seems to me remote indeed. So we don't have the unanimity that Lord Walker spoke about. So none of this reciprocal monitoring, certainly no tolerance of error, because we're not going to refer the question. We're not going to refer the question. So I think perhaps you can see that there is, well, perhaps the straitjacket is not as tight as you might think it is, if you've got the option of whether or not to refer. Perhaps another area, the elaboration of citizenship, Article 20 of the Treaty, and I think that you might look at the case law which elaborates on the fundamental status of EU citizens, and I think that you'll find in all of those paragraphs instances in which that fundamental status is elaborated. So citizenship should not lead to an unreasonable burden on public finances. You have to show a certain degree of integration into the society, of the host state. The national authorities have the power to assess whether the grant of social security benefit could place a burden on that member state's social assistance systems. So it is up to the nation states, it is up to the member states of the EU to legislate on the access to benefits. This is not something that is dictated. And this emerged in, well, two German cases, Dano and Aleminovich, on the German limits to social security. And here we have paragraph 105. Member states can refuse to grant social assistance to citizens who exercise their right to freedom of movement solely in order to obtain the social assistance of another member state. So the member state can actively legislate on benefits. You don't have to go to an intergovernmental conference to address these issues. But of course, Dano was addressing inactivity, economic inactivity, and the access to benefits. I think in the intergovernmental conference, remember, we were talking about an emergency brake on in-work benefits, and that limitation of exported child benefit. Of course, we can disagree with the court's approach. Those using their free movement rights used to be seen as the heroes of market integration. That when you crossed a border and took up a job in another member state, you were doing something positive for the EU. This case law makes people think, well, those people making use of those free movement rights are doing something wrong. They're no longer the heroes of market integration. And they're not necessarily crossing the border in order to work. And I think these are difficult ideas. Clearly, the Court of Justice is swimming in a new direction on these questions. And so I think we can revisit that straitjacket. We can contrast national approaches to referrals, and we can see that there is quite a lot of leeway in that straitjacket. And we can see that member states have got that power to legislate on benefits. And so I suppose that's the point on the nature of this straitjacket. Article 50 and the withdrawal process, and of course a great deal has been reported on this. I think we can look at Article 50 of the Lisbon Treaty, which now governs the process. And I think there are a number of questions that follow on from Article 50. I think we have looked at this idea of whether parliamentary confirmation is required of the referendum, whether the executive has to obtain parliamentary approval, whether the prerogative is constrained by the European Communities Act. The royal prerogative is residual. It is superseded by subsequent legislation. How rapid does notification have to be under Article 50? Can the 2-year deadline for negotiations be extended? Can a fresh parliament unwind the process and retain the UK's pre-Brexit status? Is a second referendum required? Can Parliament simply bypass Article 50 and repeal the European Communities Act? A million questions flow from Article 50. We're in no man's land. And of course, what are the status of affected EU and UK nationals? Is it that date of the referendum, the 23rd of June? Or is it the 31st of March, which is, well, perhaps that's the date that the negotiations begin? And I think last Thursday we had the first partial clarification of these questions, that the government simply cannot, under the royal prerogative, trigger Article 50. So that's the first hurdle, and it was seen that the judgment was taken that would fail on the first hurdle. We require a vote in Parliament. It's not simply a question that can be resolved by the royal prerogative. And this was the reaction of the media to this decision. The enemies of the people, that the judges deciding on this case were the enemies of the people. And I think I'll leave that link, you can follow that link to that article in the Daily Mail. So, I think that you can see how complex this withdrawal process is going to be. One of the suggestions now is to have a vote of confidence in the negotiation strategy. One of the reasons for not having a full debate has been put forward as not allowing others to see the renegotiation strategy. So you want to keep your renegotiation strategy safe from the people, or perhaps from other governments. Very briefly, potential status outside the EU. And I think that we may all have heard of these different models of association with the EU, but clearly the association model in the Norwegian case also involves a level of contributions to the EU budget. The Swiss model, perhaps this also involves certain shortcomings. There is no institutional infrastructure. In other words, there's no pathway, if you've got litigation, from a Swiss court to the Court of Justice. And this does lead to, it leads to problems for undertakings, because they can never be sure about what EU law means in Switzerland. So what they've traditionally done is they've gone to London for legal advice, on the extent of their EU obligations. So this is quite an issue. And of course, now a lot of UK lawyers are having to get accreditation in Ireland in order to advise on EU law. So that's the next stage. And of course, the Council itself has said that we're not going to do any more of these bilateral agreements, these Swiss-style agreements, because they're simply too complex. And I suppose from the undertaking's perspective, it doesn't give the undertaking the legal certainty that it needs. The World Trade Organization, well, then you've got all these issues on the imposition of tariffs on exports. And of course, that has been a tremendous issue in the northeast of England, especially for Nissan. And I think this is another issue of tariffs being imposed. The margins on car production are very low. The tariffs normally exceed those profit margins. And then we have this idea of the UK free trade agreement. And of course, that would be a new kind of mixed agreement, something completely new, sui generis. And I think there are all sorts of problems, some of which I've put up on the slide there. Some brief conclusions on these issues. Well, perhaps the result of the referendum was quite a surprise. It seemed to take the Brexit side by surprise. Certainly the current foreign minister was quite surprised with the result. But perhaps for others, it came as less of a surprise. And of course, this is one of, this is quite a provocative idea that when the then French president rejected the UK application to join the EU, President de Gaulle said that to open the EU to the UK was to enter a world of delay, artifice, and make-believe. That the EU had taken such a lot of work to put together that this was a very difficult step. So perhaps President de Gaulle might not have been surprised by the referendum result. Perhaps he saw that one coming in 1967. He knew how 50 years later the people would vote. But perhaps we can think of perhaps a rebooting of the relationship. Perhaps there's a more positive way of looking at these developments. All fresh starts offer new opportunities. And I suppose there could be an enhancement of the negotiating climate. Perhaps the legislative procedure inside the EU might be more manageable. Certainly the size of the parliament is reduced. There is a move away from ad hoc solutions, perhaps less Europe a la carte. Perhaps EU capacity can be directed at new problems, the Eurozone crisis, which still exists, the refugee crisis, Russian aggression, that these can play a greater role, that these can be addressed. More Europe, or a more social Europe. I think these ideas of a European avant-garde or a Kern-Europa might be promoted. And clearly the Eurozone will gain stature inside the EU. Now these could be seen as great opportunities, but perhaps there's also a danger here that the EU loses some of its diversity. It loses some of its character. It loses some of its competition of ideas. And I think that is a very significant flaw. For the UK, well, there are a number of challenges. And I think I've just put down one or two of these challenges. This idea of taking back control. It is a very attractive proposition, but of course the devil is in the detail. How do you take back control and not reimpose an outer border to the EU on the inner Irish border? This is a very sensitive topic. Free trade, something that a lot of Brexiteers want, but when they go to Australia, they find that there's less enthusiasm in Australia to accept free trade. Well, surely then, no more agricultural subsidies. And that's a tremendous issue. And sometimes it pays to think about those positions outside the EU, that we frequently just have this European way of looking at the EU. Viewed from Australia, viewed from New Zealand, the EU does seem like quite a protectionist organisation. Free trade in services, can that be achieved with India? And I think the Prime Minister speaking today in India made it very clear that there will be no increase in migration from India to the UK. This would seem to be a problem to free movement of or free trade in services. Passporting of financial services. This seems to have been, at least before Thursday, the top priority to ensure that passporting of financial services. Curbs on immigration. Curbs on immigration, but at the same time allowing key staff to travel across borders. How does this, where can a compromise be made here? And of course, a significant portion of those people voting Brexit wanted increased state spending. How are all of these different promises, these almost incompatible promises, to be brought together without disappointing people? And I think it's quite difficult to see how somebody is not going to be disappointed in this process. Brexit was a coalition. It was a coalition of socially conservative people led by market liberal argument. And so how to find those points of compromise, those ways of tackling these issues. Now, I'm not sure that this is too complimentary to the Secretary of State for exiting the EU, the Foreign Office, or the Trade Secretary. They have been described as the three blind mice in the British press. This is not a very positive way of looking at three ministers. Is the office for exiting the UK prevaricating on the potential meaning of Brexit? Is there a strategy? The Foreign Office speculating on possible compromises, the Trade Secretary conducting preparatory trade talks in the shadow of Article 50 notification. What happens if all of that fails, if these strategies fail, or if there's a failure in Parliament? If there's a failure in Parliament, can parliamentary sovereignty be simply reasserted? And I think this is perhaps a provocative idea. Has parliamentary sovereignty been damaged in this process? And I think you might say that the sovereignty of the people, the people's insurgent ability to reject the last minute cheerleading for the EU in favour of a prospectus, perhaps a threadbare prospectus for more cake, that that was ultimately successful. And once sovereignty of the people is released, how easy is it to control that sovereignty? And I suppose this may be a familiar character to some of you. That's the leader of the UK Independence Party speaking after the court judgment on Thursday. He already smells betrayal, that this is a rigged game. Betrayal may be near at hand. I'm sorry, I can't impersonate Nigel Farage for you, but I think that's one idea that this is part of an establishment betrayal. The Foreign Secretary, we are going to make a titanic success of Brexit. I normally tell my... Well, I'm not sure how this works. I normally tell my titanic joke as an icebreaker. Doesn't go down too well. Perhaps we should also think on the questions that arise in referenda. What Helmut Schmidt was saying here was that you can actually undermine governance through direct democracy. And you might wonder how stable the government is now. And I think that's probably a huge issue, that the government is now very unstable. And is this an option, perhaps, towards splendid isolation? And this is what, in the 1975 referendum on joining the EU, Roy Jenkins, he compared being outside the EU to being in this old age, the old people's home for fading nations. And of course, Roy Jenkins thought that it wouldn't be a very comfortable old people's home, and that he didn't like the look of some of the potential warders. So is this a warning? Perhaps not just in the context of Brexit, but also in the context of Lexit. Could Latvia ever leave the EU? You must be mad. Latvia would never leave. Is that... That must be the consensus. Latvia could never... Perhaps we have to think about whether Latvia could leave the EU. You've got to look carefully in this whole process at the role of the press. It's very easy for the press to exaggerate every single article, to look at every single measure that is passed in a certain negative way. Does the press report on EU affairs objectively? Populism. Now, could it be conceivable that one day Nigel Farage reappears to advise a Latvian political party and he says what they should be doing or what they've been doing wrong? It's very easy to be populist, to suggest to people that they can have absolute sovereignty, and to imply to people that there are no costs. I mean, one of the costs, what has to happen now, there has to be, if the European arrest warrant, for example, is no longer in force in the UK, you need to have 27 new sets of agreements to recreate this institution. The Brussels technocracy, I think that this is perhaps something that we ignore at our peril. That if you're in Valga, Riga can seem a long way away from you, let alone Brussels. And if you're a populist, that's where you want to be moving people, where you say you're miles away from where the decisions are being taken. And perhaps Nigel would have a word to say about opportunism. You know, that you could look at past decisions, at past compromises, and try to unravel those compromises. And you can make people feel very angry if you feel that they've been betrayed by the political class. And I suppose if you don't want Brexit to happen, hard work. Everyone has a role to play, and you've got to make those protections available for people. And perhaps that's also some of the role of the RGSL, modestly enough. We have a role to play. We have a role to play in shining a light in some of these areas, in looking at those private law relationships, at looking at consumer protection, at looking at environmental protection, social security, competition law, and that making these benefits and making the complexity of these arrangements somewhat more transparent, that we also have a role to play. So, whether you're a competition lawyer or a consumer lawyer, whether you're engaging environmental standards, I think it's important, the work that we do to bring transparency into these areas. And I think that's a challenge for all of us, and it is something for all of us to try to live up to.
I'm just going to complement it, I think, by saying three things. The first of those is about what the UK government believes is its mandate to take the negotiations forward. I think it's quite important to start with that, because UK ministers believe very firmly and very strongly that the referendum has given them a very clear mandate to implement the decision to leave the EU. So from their perspective, there is now no debate about that. There is no question of a second referendum or whatever. It is simply a matter of implementing leaving the EU. Second point is about what has actually happened. Now, there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of talk, but what actually has happened? And what actually has happened are largely those bureaucratic things that you mentioned. The establishment of two new departments of state in the UK, the appointment of new ministers, so we have a new ministry, the Department for Exiting the EU, we have a new ministry, the Department for International Trade, and we have a new decision-making system. Many of you will be familiar with the way the UK government makes decisions, and because we have a cabinet which is tends to be quite large, in practice decisions tend to be made through cabinet committees. So there's a cabinet committee for leaving the EU which is chaired by the Prime Minister and includes all the main ministers, and that is the main decision-making body. I think it has met now three times and it has made no decisions. What it has done is taken a series of important papers produced by civil servants on what the options are. What are the options for leaving the customs union? What are the options for leaving the single market? What are the policy options for migration? And I think quite rightly, ministers are aware that all of these issues are deeply connected. And in tackling this big problem, it would make no sense for ministers to take one paper on migration and another paper on, you know, customs union and to make contradictory decisions. So at this stage, there have been a series of sighting discussions, a series of general discussions about the problem, and ministers have requested that officials do more work. Now, we haven't quite got a million questions yet. We've got, I think, something like 750 substantial work streams have been set up. So you can begin to see the enormity of the undertaking and how the process of leaving the EU is going to preoccupy UK public service and ministers over the next several years. The third thing I wanted to say is about what it is that we want. And although ministers have made no decisions, I think you can see in their public remarks the beginnings of some clear pointers in terms of what ministers are saying that they want. So the first point is that the language is all about the UK leaving the EU and becoming a fully independent and sovereign nation. So no question of the UK somehow taking with us some aspects of our EU membership. Simply the question that we will leave and be outside, and then we will attempt to negotiate some new arrangements with the EU as a sovereign country, like Canada. Also, I think it's very clear that there is no interest in any of those models that have been mentioned. There is no interest in the Norwegian model. There is no interest in the Swiss model. There is a belief that what is needed is a relationship that will be negotiated that suits the UK. So that is what we will be doing, is setting out an arrangement which, some proposals for an arrangement which we think will suit the UK. There's one or two other things that ministers have said which I think are quite important. One is about immigration policy, and as you've all heard, immigration was a big part of the Brexit referendum. And there ministers have said that the UK will decide as a sovereign country on what its immigration policy should be. So that is very clearly saying that immigration policy isn't something that is going to be negotiated. It's not part of these negotiations at all. In the same way that the UK decides what visa arrangements we will have for Zimbabwe, we will decide what visa arrangements we want for the rest of the EU. And then it's up to the EU to decide what the EU's response would be. So very clearly, a different world. Ministers have also said one or two reassuring things on one or two of the questions that people are most concerned about here. So the question of what happens to Latvians who are currently living and working in the UK, what happens to British people who are living and working in Europe. And there, the Prime Minister's view very clearly is that we wish and intend to negotiate an agreement which will allow the current arrangements to continue for people who are already in the UK and for British people who are already in the EU. I think I want to stop there because I want to leave some time for questions, but I'm itching to say various things on the points that you made. So hopefully that will come up in questioning and I will get the chance to sort of leap in with a few thoughts on some of the key issues.
We could go around the room first of all, perhaps.
I think 3 days ago the High Court has ruled that the government can't start the 50th article without the Parliament's approval. Do you think that it might be something like the last chance to prevent Brexit from happening, or do you think that the Parliament simply has to commit to the referendum's decision?
I think, or shall we collect questions? Is that an idea, or should we?
I'm happy. We can just do quickfire, and answer each of them if you like.
I think that one of the ideas is that perhaps this may. I mean, this shows you some of the complexity, that this wasn't foreseen, that it was thought that the government could just trigger Article 50 under those prerogative powers. So it shows you at the first testing that there was, no, that the court said, no, this has to go to Parliament. Of course, now there's a debate on exactly the kind of vote and the kind of debate that is to be held. But I don't see that this will derail the Brexit. And similarly, I don't think that there's a Greek option, you know, that you say that everything fails and then Parliament seizes sovereignty back and decides not to pursue Brexit. I think there's another issue of whether the government collapses, but that's a political issue. I don't know if the ambassador has an opinion on that one.
I think there are a couple of things to say. I mean, first of all, the formal government position is very clear that the government will appeal this decision and it will go to the Supreme Court, and the government believes that it is confident in its legal analysis and thinks there is an overwhelming mandate from the British people to leave the EU. So the government, you know, this isn't yet, you know, settled law. I mean, I did read the judgment over the weekend, and I thought actually it was a very very interesting and powerful, you know, judgment, because it summarises quite nicely the constitutional arrangement between the executive and Parliament, and quotes a number of legal opinions going back, I think, to 1610 and the glorious revolution of 1688, and makes very clear that the outcome of the Civil War was that the Crown did not have a right to take action which was in contravention of the law of Parliament. So this touches upon, I think, some extremely fundamental issues in the way the UK runs itself. I think, you know, it is probably one of the most important constitutional cases that we've had. On the politics, I think members of Parliament will be under a lot of pressure not to be seen to thwart the will of the people. But I think it's also, you know, clear that there isn't an obvious majority in Parliament for any one particular model of leaving the EU. And as you said, Mel, the insurgency campaign to leave the EU was a coalition of people who believe a range of contradictory and different things. So for the government to be able to get a mandate from Parliament to conduct negotiations to deliver a particular outcome, I think will be quite challenging. I'll just leave it there.
At the back, perhaps.
Yes, Professor, I have a hypothetical question related to the role of the European Union Court. I assume that the Brexit, if completed, will require a court review process, some needs and arrangements that will be agreed with the rest of the European Union. So can it change the role of the European Union Court as a result of the fact that it will be an arbitrator between an EU and its institutions and a non-EU member due to the past relationship that will still have certain obligations to be triggered by both parties towards each other? And will it not, again, hypothetically, bring the European Union Court to an elevated level of taking care of, for instance, the role of other bodies in international relationship as to the European Union citizen, for instance? Something that our Eastern neighbors claim to do, where they take care of their citizens at all. So it's slightly hypothetical, and I will definitely, I'm not insisting that you answer it directly, but thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the question. I think it's if the UK leaves the EU, I think the UK has made it very clear that it's leaving the jurisdiction of the court, and that EU law is no longer applicable. I think that it is an irony that I think I pointed to a number of cases where the atmosphere in the court towards the fundamental status of EU citizens seems to have changed. And certainly that judicial activism that students of EU law certainly see in that early case law seems to have been reversed over the last few years. And I think it does open up a broader question in a way that the UK had achieved so much within the EU. Now, we looked at that special status that the EU had before the IGC. And even those concessions that the IGC were prepared to negotiate were not enough in the referendum. Now, they were seen as, because they didn't go as far as the Bloomberg speech, they were seen as a climb down. Whereas, I presume from a Latvian perspective, that was a real concession. And I think that's part of the difficulty here in these negotiations. Now, when you negotiate and you achieve a concession, is that seen as a kind of benchmark, for the future? But I think that on your direct question on the court, I think it won't be called upon by the UK. The UK will be outside of the court's jurisdiction. And the irony is that the court's ethos seems to have been changing in the last few years. At the back, please.
I've got two questions. The first question, do you believe that the referendum in UK was in not really good time? I mean, during all the crisis in EU, the economical crisis in Greece and other countries, the refugee crisis in the EU, I think it was not the best time to organize the referendum. And the people are afraid of all this terrible things. Maybe you should have done it a bit earlier, or maybe a bit later, when it's all settled down. I know it was on the to-do list during the Prime Minister's campaign by the government. But maybe you should organize a bit later, and the people will feel more safer, and maybe the results will be more different. And the second question, according to the press release on the RGSL site, I've seen that one of the reasons of the Brexit was the Russian aggression. And the question is, I think that the rich people feel that we would be more safe outside of the EU, even if they're a member of the NATO still. What's this, the Russian aggression to the Brexit? I mean, this is the two questions. Thank you.
Shall I say that one? I mean, I think there's a pretty short answer to both questions. The timing of the referendum was entirely the result of UK internal political issues. Some might say entirely about Conservative Party internal management issues. So I don't think in any way you should look at it in terms of timing of whatever else is going on in the world. This was something that was driven by internal UK political issues, not by external issues. And second, on the security question, I think I would pick up from what Mel was saying about the background and perhaps go one step further. For people in the UK, the EU is not about security. And therefore, there was really no debate about whether leaving the EU would have any impact on the security of Europe. It was simply accepted by all sides in the debate that there was security in Europe, that the EU had played a role historically in bringing the countries of Europe together, and it was now irrelevant in terms of security. So you don't believe conspiracy theories about the role of Russia or whatever in the referendum. In fact, just to add a little bit to that, and I think I would go further than Mel, even in looking at the roots of Euroscepticism in the UK. I mean, I think I'd go right back to the time when the UK joined what was then the European Community, and that referendum in 1974, which basically said, it's all about trade. And that's why we're joining. The UK economy hasn't been doing very well. France and Germany have been doing very well. Joining the European Community would enable British companies to benefit. It was sold to people as a trading relationship. And I mean, ever since then, there has been a strand of Eurosceptic opposition to the EU within UK politics. I remember very briefly working with the person who is now our international, who's now our Brexit minister, David Davis, when he was a junior minister in the Foreign Office during the Maastricht negotiations. And I think he represents a strand of thinking within the Conservative Party that saw the succession of EU treaties as a power grab by the EU against the sovereignty of nations. And they would say that a key moment was Mrs. Thatcher's Bruges speech and the Bruges group which arose from that, who set themselves against ever closer union and set themselves against the direction of travel of the EU. On the other hand, I would also go further than that in terms of how successful we have been in making the EU into a place where the UK should feel comfortable. Because the single market was largely a project inspired by the UK. Enlargement was something that we, Germany and others, drove forward. So actually, if you look at what has happened to the EU over the last 40 years, it has become something very much closer to the kind of organization that the UK said it wanted 30 or 40 years ago. So there is a big tension between those bits of the UK government that want the single market to work properly, are still campaigning for the completion of the single market, the extension of the single market to services, for example, or energy, and those bits of the political system who are enthralled to this idea that somehow the EU is merely a bureaucratic enterprise which limits people's freedom, which is very much the sort of flavour of the tabloid press.
Perhaps if I just add 2 points, I think that there was this presumption with the government that it was quite an obvious proposition. No, I think that the government was surprised by, and I think that was a surprise that was quite broadly felt, that the Brexit proposition proved to be as lethal as it proved to be. I think there's also this issue that certainly the UK did achieve an awful lot of its objectives within the EU. And I wonder whether there were important opportunities that were missed during the treaty revisions to make the kind of alliances that would have perhaps been beneficial. I'm thinking particularly of the Amsterdam Treaty, which was seen by many commentators in Central Europe as being so far down the road to perdition that, you know, some called it, you know, that Europe was Amsterdammed by the treaty. But I thought that was perhaps that's going too far.
Yeah, I mean, there have been countervailing political pressures. I mean, during Tony Blair's government, I think he famously said that he wanted to put the UK at the heart of Europe. So there have been, you know, periods when the pendulum has swung the other way, and the UK has been, you know, UK politicians have been more enthusiastic.
Perhaps at the back.
Yeah, both.
You go first.
I'm glad you mentioned Tony Blair as the charge of affair, because it was under his government, I think, that the liberalisation of the press took a turn. And I'd like to hear both of your opinions on how crucial the press has been in this campaign, as I believe, as a UK citizen, a lot of disinformation, more than information, was disseminated, and why the government didn't allow that to happen.
Oh my. I suppose the government doesn't really control the press, but
that was going to be my line. I mean, I think the Prime Minister was asked about this on her way to India, and I think, you know, what she said was a good script for me, which is that she said that, you know, both judicial independence and freedom of the press are important and vital underpinnings for a democratic society. So I think, you know, we can all camp on that in that place. Your question is quite a deep one about what has happened to that debate, and, you know, rather than, if you like, blaming the press, I think, you know, the thing to do is to reflect on what have we done as the UK government in terms of trying to explain the EU and what it means to people in the UK. And, you know, it may be quite difficult to explain the EU, but I think it's pretty clear that we have not been very successful in doing that. One thing that I recall from the referendum campaign was the Remain campaign thinking about how to communicate the benefits of EU membership. And an obvious place to start is to talk about the single market and the value that brings in terms of jobs and consumer prices and so on. But when they did the focus groups, they discovered that saying that the single market was a good thing didn't shift the dial at all, because people didn't know what you were talking about when you talked about the single market. So I think, you know, the discourses have become entirely disconnected. There has been this discourse in the tabloid press that the EU is all about regulations of the curvature of cucumbers, and there has been a discourse at professional, legal, institutional level, which has been about, you know, the single market and how that works, and these two things have simply not been connected. There was an article, again, reading in the press over the weekend, which I thought was quite good, saying that the UK is, in a funny way, doing the referendum all the wrong way around. We had the vote first, and now we're having the discussion about what the EU means. I think it's to be encouraged that we have a continued discussion about what it is that the EU actually means in practice, because there are some really difficult things to square here. A lot of if you look at the language that ministers use, they talk about access to the single market. Now, what does that mean? I don't know. Does that mean the UK is part of the single market, or in some way subject to the key? Or does it mean that the UK is outside like a foreign country selling things in. Well, if it means that, then it doesn't mean anything much at all, because you know, anyone has access to the single market. It's just, you know, you make something, you meet the standards, and you can sell it. But if it's to mean more than that, then how are we going to construct something which is acceptable to UK people and politicians in terms of sovereignty, and yet, you know, which can somehow still capture the benefits of being part of a system of regulation which provides common regulation for business. And I don't know how we're going to do that. But one thing is clear is that the Prime Minister doesn't accept it as a binary decision. You know, it is not a question of being in the single market or out of the single market. It is our job, and something that everyone can contribute to try to work out how to square that circle, and in what way can we come up with some arrangement which is a win-win solution for the UK and the other 27 members of the EU.
Perhaps just to add a few points, I mean, the Abbey National case that I referred to, I mean, you can look at it at two levels. You can say that the first issue was that the directive was copy-pasted into the UK regulations. And that could have been picked up on by the media, for example, as problematic. The whole idea of directives is that it's meant to give the member states some sort of leeway in the implementation of EU law. Now, if you choose not to do that, you then have to deal with the enforcement of EU law. And that's on the second step that the Supreme Court didn't refer the question of the interpretation of the copy-pasted directive to the Court of Justice of the EU. Then you have millions of disillusioned consumers who say, why am I paying these inflated bank charges? And in the public discourse, it's a question of EU law. So having failed to implement the directive accurately, having simply copy-pasted it into the regulations, and then having left the question of interpretation, having not referred the question to interpretation, you can see in the way that, and I think this is what the some of the frustration is, that you know, you have a certain responsibility, you know, of government and of the judiciary to this kind of Eurosceptical debate. It's very difficult to put that plastically to people. You know, it doesn't make an easy headline to say that, you know, in these two steps of, you know, transposition and interpretation, things have gone wrong, and they're not necessarily to be placed at the doorstep of the EU as a failure of the EU. But that's how this question emerged. And you have to remember that was for bank charges. That was for inflated bank charges. Overwhelmingly, it was students that were involved, because oddly enough, of all groups of society, students find it most difficult in arranging their finances. I was trying to be a little bit little tongue-in-cheek there, but I suppose the other idea is that, you know, is it all about, you know, the UK media? Is this all a group of Australian, wild Australian interests? Well, there is an element of that, but, you know, even in the independent press, I think the technocratic aspect of Brussels was very unpopular. Very few people, and I think it's something that, you know, whether you're in the UK or in the EU, it is a worry that the EU is identified with a Brussels technocracy. And, you know, perhaps serious thought has to be given to this. It cannot be that Brussels is only seen as a kind of collection of skyscrapers and these faceless bureaucrats. I think also in this question of regulation, somehow there has to be this bonfire of regulation. I think that was promised by the Brexit side. But if the bonfire of regulation doesn't relate to product standards, And it doesn't relate to consumer protection because the consumers have to have the confidence to buy the cross-border traded goods as well. Well, then you're just left with a rump of employment protections. And I'm not sure that any government will throw those employment protections onto any bonfire. Perhaps you have to have a last minute renaming of all of these instruments and then put a lot of blank sheets of paper on the bonfire.
I mean, on that, I mean, there is, I think, some clear policy that the government will introduce what they call the Great Repeal Bill, and that would be the mechanism for the repeal of the 1972 Act, which is the Act which essentially establishes the supremacy of EU law in the UK and provides a mechanism for the enactment of EU instruments. The government has also been clear that legislation will enact into UK law all the existing EU legislation. So, you know, it might perhaps also be seen as the Great Enactment Act, because what it will actually have to do is take 40 years worth of legislation and put it into UK statute. Sadly, that isn't going to simply be a question of cutting and pasting, because in many cases the legislation will refer to EU bodies. So, you know, legislation on medicines might refer to the European Medicines Agency based in London. And will have to refer to some other body, and some other body will have to be set up to provide that regulation in the UK, presumably. So you can see, again, that just a hint of what a big undertaking it is going to be to just get all of that legislation in place in order to maintain continuity, so that on day one of leaving the EU, there isn't a legal vacuum.
Perhaps right at the back, should we collect a few questions?
Yes.
Is that an idea?
Question about something that hasn't been discussed yet, I think it should be. We should also remember that the UK itself is a union consisting of Scotland, England, Wales, and Northern Ireland. And as we saw a slide in the beginning with statistics on how they voted, and Scotland and Northern Ireland voted for remaining in the EU. Now, with regards to Theresa May's negotiations with the EU, Nicola Sturgeon, and the First Minister of Scotland, has already said that she is willing to trigger a second referendum in Scotland to get the Scottish interest through. Is this part of the contingency plan of Theresa May with regard to the Brexit negotiations?
Shall we collect some questions? I think we had a question at the back, was that?
Yes. Shifting from the trade within the EU to the international trade, the EU has negotiated CETA, the free trade agreement with Canada recently, and the TTIP deal with the US is in process. And as I understand, the UK is part of the EU, still negotiating the deals within the EU right now. So, what is going to be the government's policies in terms of these deals a few years later, 2 years later, when the UK is most likely to leave the EU, but will still be kind of a part of these deals, and how is it going to be replaced, or how is it going to be dealt with in terms of TTIP or CETA?
I think we have one question in the front.
I'd like to ask a question about legal aspects of Brexit. I'm not a lawyer, and that's why I would like more clarification about this referendum. As I understand, it was not legally binding. Yes. It means decision to leave the EU has not taken yet. And if so, which institution in the UK has authority to take this decision? government figure article in March next year, and discussion is the EU will result is no agreement. Does it mean that UK will leave EU in 2 years without decision to leave EU?
I suppose the 2 year period, I think that's where we really are in a no man's land. Can that 2 year period be extended? You know, that would be, you know, if the process runs, if the process takes that much time, can it be easily extended? I suppose there is a pragmatic reason why it can't be, is that's because of the EU elections, which I think are in 2019, in the autumn of 2019. So I suppose that really informs the Brexit, the triggering of Article 50. Again, it is Parliament that makes that. It's Parliament that makes the decision. It's not taken. I mean, that's what the court was clarifying on Thursday. It's Parliament that takes the decision, and this all goes back to this wonderful case of proclamations in 1610, under the reign of James the Sixth of Scotland and James the First of England, and he was the. So this is how we get to Scotland, but. This is the idea. This was the, and I suppose that was the debate between Parliament and the King wanted to rule by proclamation, rule through his prerogatives, and Parliament wanted to control the power of the monarch. So this is where you get that old debate between King and Parliament, and that of course continued into because. James the Sixth son, that was Charles the First, and of course these arguments on the relationship between Parliament and the monarchy, they led to the the death of Charles the First. But we're getting into constitutional history here. So it's Parliament who decides. I think there are pragmatic reasons why that 2 year period, it's difficult to conceive that the 2 year period will be extended. I think I'll leave to.
Okay. I mean, I think the government's view is that it hasn't actually been decided yet, you know, and it will be decided by this agreement court. And I mean, just, I'm not a lawyer, but just to give you my sort of very simplistic perspective as a civil servant, you know, it always struck me as quite strange that I, working in the Foreign Office, didn't have to worry about domestic law very much, because you know, all of international relations is something that happens, you know, under these so-called prerogative powers. The government just gets on and does it. And if the government negotiates a treaty, the government can negotiate whatever treaty it likes, because that does not impact on domestic law. And the government then has to go to Parliament and pass a law in order to implement the treaty. So international relations and domestic law, you know, are two, you know, distinct areas. And the complexity of this case, of course, is that the 1972 Act actually brings an international treaty directly into UK domestic law. So the fundamental claim of the plaintiffs was that leaving the EU would impact on their rights, and that's what the court judgment has found. I mean, interestingly, one of the things that everybody agreed was that once you trigger Article 50, there's no going back. Therefore, that there is a 2 year deadline. I think also that would be politically very difficult to extend, both for EU countries to extend or for the UK government to extend, because a lot of people in the UK are saying 2 years, 2 years to leave the EU, you know, we're to leave next week, please. You know, why don't we just abrogate the treaty and leave? That's it, walk away. So I think practical politics, as seen at the moment, extension very unlikely, but who knows? Scotland, should we
Scotland, yeah.
Okay, Scotland. I don't think it's, I mean, your question was, is it part of a plan? And I think the answer is no. Again, from a UK government point of view, I think the government would assert that the legal position is pretty clear, that Parliament in Westminster is sovereign, and it is the UK government which has devolved powers to Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. And if Westminster wishes to undevolve those powers or do whatever it likes, Westminster can do that. And there are clauses within the legislation reserving to Westminster the power to legislate on areas of international relations or whatever. So I think legally, and but you can argue about it, I mean legally, you know, there is a purist constitutional law view which basically says the UK government can do what it likes. Or the UK Parliament can do what it likes. But of course, it's actually really a political question. I think, you know, what we should do is look and see what happens in terms of Brexit. And if Brexit is a big success, as UK ministers have asserted, and once freed from this bureaucratic straitjacket, the UK economy is going to boom, and it's going to demonstrate everything they've been saying for many years about the sclerotic situation in the EU. If that happens, then I think it's very unlikely to be a referendum in Scotland, because the government there would judge that they wouldn't win the referendum. If, on the other hand, Brexit proves to be quite challenging and the UK economy doesn't do well, then I think it's much more likely that public opinion would be such that the government in Scotland would see it as an opportune moment to call a referendum. And I think, you know, you can see that having lost a referendum once, the government of Scotland is going to want to be very confident of winning a referendum before setting a date for a second referendum. What was the third question?
The international trade, wasn't it? The question on the ongoing negotiations, and of course, I suppose the UK is trying to negotiate, or will be trying to negotiate, precisely these kind of international agreements. And I think that I don't know whether the government has a view on whether this would be more of a challenge in the current environment, where there seems to be a much more protectionist atmosphere developing. Again, I suppose this is more of a, well, it's also heavily influenced, as was the question in Scotland, very heavily influenced by politics. You know, this is hardly something that we can really predict what will be the atmosphere for these negotiations.
I think the honest answer is we haven't even begun to get to these issues. You know, there are at the moment, you know, two political views. On the one hand, there is the view that Brexiteers would take that the UK outside the EU can quickly strike a range of deals. I think one Brexiteer minister famously said we could negotiate free trade agreements with an area 10 times the size of the EU, which is slightly larger than the global population at the moment, but you know, the spirit of what he's saying is clear. On the other hand, that would be practically quite challenging. And if you look at recent progress on trade agreements, you see that they take many years. And so there is an obvious challenge. If you leave the EU and you don't have those free trade agreements, how long realistically would it take to put those in place? And I think that takes me to another point which is worth thinking about. Again, not a formal UK government position, but just an observation that we may need to think about the negotiations in sort of three areas. The first is the divorce arrangements, who pays the salaries of the MEPs and who gets the wine cellar and all that kind of dividing up the assets and liabilities stuff. Then there's the question about what the future trade arrangement is going to be, which another big chunk of of stuff. But it may be that we will need to have a third negotiation, which is what some sort of interim transition arrangements are going to be. And the more you look at the complexity of what we've got to negotiate, the more it suggests that some sort of transition arrangements may be needed. Although when you start to think about those transition arrangements, it's quite difficult to see how you could negotiate something that would meet the political requirements that isn't just as difficult as negotiating the final arrangements. So, quite difficult, but you can begin to see that it's one of the things that ends up in that box of stuff for transition arrangements. You know, how can the UK participate in existing free trade arrangements until separate arrangements have been negotiated?
And I think that the multi-dimensional scale of these negotiations is almost overwhelming. I mean, you were talking about 750 work streams. I mean, this is it's very difficult to put timetables on these kind of processes, and the scale of the work is unprecedented.
I have one final remark, I guess. We're on the subject of negotiations. Is there a contingency plan on negotiations depending on tomorrow's big results? Does the UK have anything? I mean, we've got somebody on the other side of the pond saying we're going to be extremely protectionist. We're going to bring jobs back into the US. And that person looks like they are most likely going to probably win the election, which is a scary prospect. Would that convince the UK somehow negotiating a more closer deal? Or is that not even on the table?
I think it's quite difficult to develop contingency plans when it's very, very unclear what a Trump presidency would mean in practice. And I think, for everything that he said, I can probably think about something that he said which may suggest the opposite. So, you know, he's also said that he would be enthusiastic about negotiating a free trade agreement with the UK. So, I'm sure that, that there has been some thought given to how to engage quickly with the Republican team, but I'm not privy to that or going to start talking about it. And I think in a way the whole all the work that we need to do on Brexit is sufficiently complicated without having to try to think about the impact of US elections.
I was going to say that's far too sensitive a question for the director of the RGSL to comment on, but perhaps also you might think about some of the comments that his opponent has also raised, some of the objections. It's by no means that's an exclusive opinion of one part of the political spectrum. And I think that's a fear, isn't it? That there is a lot of mileage to be made. And we might think of that inside Latvia as well. You know, a populist always has an easy job. They don't, and of course you might say that Jack Falstaff famously played dead when the Scots arrive on the scene. And this is where his great speech, "Discretion is the greater part of valor," comes from. You're never there when the action takes place. And of course, Nigel Farage has famously gone on some sort of sabbatical now, just as the work is starting. So this is, I think it's the detail work, that's the difficult work. And it's very easy for politicians of whatever colour to take a very populist stance on this. And that hasn't been restricted to Donald Trump. And that's a worry, that if this protectionist argument takes takes hold, then all of us suffer. And on that positive note...